Now, after our call to worship, that's what we will see. So, if you don't have it memorized, if you would, have your finger over 388, and we'll crank that up, and we'll do something from another part of the world.
Good.
It's outside of some of our comfort zones. That's good. We'll get more comfortable with it. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert. Thank you, choir. And thank you, worshipers, congregation, for practicing. I'm Wanda Neely, and it is a privilege to welcome you here in worship at that part of the body of Christ called First Presbyterian. I have the privilege of serving here as the interim at Reverend Adam Bowling. Pastor Adam, our associate, will be bringing a message today. And we thank the choir and Robert and the ushers and the greeters, and the sound folks, the live stream people, everyone who is helping us worship the Lord today. I'll call your attention to announcements in the bulletin. Let's talk about today. First, today, we are inviting everyone here, everyone, to stay for lunch and to hear and meet our special guest, Principal Chrissy. She said she tried to teach me how to pronounce her last name, and finally she just gave me permission to say Principal Chrissy. So thank you, Principal. Principal Chrissy is here from the Ebenezer Institute of Learning from Malawi, Africa. That is a school that this presbytery helped build and start with a grant from a church in this presbytery. Please stay and see the amazing story of the school and what is going on there. And join us for lunch. If you did not bring anything, you still get to stay for lunch. And we're asking everybody to chip in and help cover for chicken, because we are dividing our brothers and sisters from Quaker Methodist Presbyterian and Green Street Presbyterian and to be our guest for lunch. And so we are going to do a chicken run. And it looks like it's Scott and Scott. Scott and Scott, Coley and Davis, who are doing our chicken run for us. So while I'm doing announcements, I'll ask you to chip in for chicken. Chip in for chicken. Now, while they're doing that, let me tell you that we have a ritual of friendship here, and it goes like this. You find the black friendship pad, and everybody here fills out that pad. So find that black pad, and everybody signs in. And one of the things you may choose to do on that friendship pad is sign up for Wednesday supper. The menu, the information about Wednesday, it's hard to compete with a chicken. That's okay. You're doing great, chickens. Chicken Scott. One of the things with the friendship pad you can do is sign up for Wednesday supper. Information about that is on the back cover of your bulletin, including the program, which will be about our children who participated this year, this spring, in Bible Club. And then we'll be doing our program, so it's going to be lots of fun. So sign up for that. Everyone, please sign the friendship pad, pass it down, and send it back. There's other information in your bulletin about other things happening today, our speaker today at our luncheon, this week, Wednesday night, as well as Thursday. Thursday is the National Day of Prayer. The gathering in Morganton will be at noon at the old courthouse on the square. Then there's information in there about collecting graduate, information on graduates, and information about next Sunday. Notice, next Sunday, usher training. This is not just for people who have already been ushering. It is for you, too. It's a refresher, and you're going to help teach the workshop. But it's also for anybody who thinks you can take a turn, male or female. We need some more women helping with this. If you can take a turn ushering, please plan to stay about 30, 40 minutes after worship next Sunday, and we will do a time together talking about how we welcome and extend hospitality in Christ's name in this place. Also, next Sunday, Sunday School Teacher Appreciation, and then next Sunday afternoon is the Presbyterian Women's Tea. And those are our announcements. Anything else? Okay. Then let me ask you to stand, please, and let us use the words printed in the bulletin to call ourselves to worship. And then we will go into the song that Mr. Smith has taught us. As the weak realize their strength, as the poor eat and are satisfied,
God's love abides in us.
As the stranger finds a friend, as the family offers forgiveness,
God's love abides in us.
As the ends of the earth know of God's grace,
God's love abides in us.
Let us worship God.
You ask us to love others as you have loved us. You give us a simple command to love, and we complicate it with rules, worries, and doubts. Forgive us, by your word, for we sometimes struggle to love the people in our lives as you have loved us. You have planted the seeds of mercy, of hope, of grace deep within us, so we might bear rich and nourishing fruit for others. May we not give the way of you, the Master Gardener, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who will use the Holy Spirit to bring forth an abundant crop. Hear us now as we continue to pray in the silence of our hearts.
Thank you.
She's a principal, yes. What are your principal's names at your schools? Gregory?
Mr. Mayo.
Mayo? Yeah, the same. This is Principal Christie, and I'm going to let her say her last name for you.
It's Mewe. M-B-E-W-E. So it's pronounced Mewe. Yes. So the first name is Christie, and the surname is Mewe.
You want to hold that? I'm holding that. I brought some pictures from her school, and she says these are dated, but I think that they're still very helpful for us to see what her school is like. Her school, and she came from a long way away from here. Where did you hear where she's from?
Africa.
Africa. You remember the country?
Malawi.
Yes. That's southeastern Africa.
Central.
Okay. I know it does not touch the coast.
No, we are not good.
Here's some pictures from her school. This is the students studying. They wear uniforms. Anybody wear uniforms? Y'all do. Okay. They wear red shirts and blue shorts or skirts.
Yes.
But most of the pictures I printed are from their sports day, because I know some of you are getting ready to have your, do you call them field days? Yeah. Is that what you call them? We call them field days here.
Yeah.
But it's the same as sports day, and so I thought you might enjoy seeing the pictures. Here they are, and you notice that they have, some of them have blue stripes on. Well, I studied the picture, and I saw that they divided into teams.
Yes.
Is that right?
Yes.
And they mix, you go from pre-kindergarten all
yes.
the way through
grade
seven.
Yes.
Which is the last grade.
The last grade, yes. It's a point where they'll exit into secondary school.
Or high school, as we call it. So ours starts at ninth grade. Here it's at her school it starts at eighth grade. So can you see the boys and girls that are wearing red? They're the Lions. They divided up into, and they mixed up. This
yes.
is a great way to do it,
yes.
10 through 7.
Yes.
And then the ones wearing yellow are leopards, and the ones wearing blue are, can you see?
Cheetahs.
Those are the three teams. And here's some of the activities they did. Do you know, this one's called, when I was growing up, we called this a wheelbarrow. Wheelbarrow. You still call it that? Somebody has to walk on their, that's hard. You walk on your hands while somebody holds your feet. So you have one set of hands and one set of legs from somebody else in a relay. What's this one? Or sack race, we called it way back when we had sacks instead of bags. What's this one called?
Three-legged
race. Yes, when you tie two legs together. And then, let me see if I found the picture I really liked. Okay. Oh, this one. This is, what is this, can you tell?
Tug
of war. Between who, can you tell?
The teachers.
The teachers and the students. because we want to say, we want to commission you and say a prayer over you. Here they come. So, I'm not going to make everybody sit down, so I'm going to let us stand up. And I'm going to, okay, I have something for the children to give you. These are prayer squares. That is a special ministry of our church that Marge Powell does for us. And I want you to give, each one of these individuals needs two prayer squares. These folks, Principal Chrissy will be returning to Malawi, and these two individuals will be going as part of our team to go visit Malawi. So give, make sure each one of these individuals has two prayer squares, any two. And your charge to you is to take these prayer squares, take one with you. It says, may this prayer square allow you to feel God's presence and love. First Presbyterian Church, Morganton. So you take one as you travel this long journey, knowing that our prayers are going with you. And then somewhere, sometime on the journey, find someone with whom to share the other prayer square and let them know you are praying for them. Okay. So we're going to lead them in a prayer, but first we want Pastor Adam to take a picture. So you kids come stand here, and we're going to wave and wave to the children at the Ebenezer Institute of Learning. How do we say hello? How do we say hello?
Morning.
Morning.
Yes.
Moni.
Moni.
Yes. M-O-N-I.
M-O-N-I. Okay, you got it, guys? Say it again.
Moni.
You guys too, wave.
Moni.
Do it one more time. You got it? Okay. You got it? Okay.
I think so. Let's wave one more time. I want to wave.
Moni. Okay. We're going to Africa, guys. Now, I'm going to ask the boys and girls, will you help me? I'm going to say prayer for them as they go. This is their commission. So will you say the words after me? Dear God.
Dear God.
Go with Principal Chrissy.
Go with Principal Chrissy.
As she returns home.
As she returns home.
Be with her.
Be with her.
Be with the students.
Be with the students.
Be with the teachers.
Be with the teachers.
And go with our team.
And go with our team.
As they travel.
As they travel.
Be with them.
Be with them.
As they meet you.
As they meet you.
In others.
In others.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Please join me in the prayer printed in the bulletin.
have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me, you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The text that Elsie just read about Jesus as the vine is one of my favorite passages of Scripture. I looked it up, and this is the third time I have preached on this text since arriving at First Presbyterian almost 11 years ago. The last time I preached on the vine and the branches was in 2016, and my family had just found out that the child we were expecting that November had passed away. This was the first of two difficult miscarriages we would experience in 3 years, and it was a very difficult time for us. Now, some of you may be thinking, and I mainly mention this as a teachable moment, that look, it all turned out okay in the end. The new baby girl, Lily Page, is scheduled to arrive this week. While that is true, a child being born still does not lessen the loss and grief for families who experience miscarriage. One of the hospice chaplains that visited a while back for a Wednesday night program talked about the most important thing that you can do for a person when they experience loss and grief, and that is to show up. Your ministry of presence. Even if you don't know what to say, just show up. That is what is most important. And the other thing you can do is avoid saying the wrong thing. Examples of the wrong thing to say when someone is grieving, and I've heard many of them. God needed another angel in heaven. Well, at least you can have other children. At least you lived a long life. Many people die young. There is a reason for everything. See, she was such a good person, God wanted her to be with him. Well, I know how you feel. There are other statements as well. All of these are unhelpful things to say when the ones we love are grieving. Joseph Tabor, a child of this church and the minister at Lowell Presbyterian, posted this on his Facebook page April 10th. If you offer comfort to someone grieving and start their sentence with, at least, you might be comforting yourself rather than them. When I think back to those difficult weeks and months, you, the congregation of First Presbyterian, were there for us. You showed up, even if you didn't know what to say. So I want to thank you again, family of First Presbyterian, for your prayers, support, love, and care. For God had surrounded us with the most amazing community even before we had these miscarriages. The outpouring of love from our friends and family sustained us. Our hearts were overwhelmed with gratitude, and God has granted us a peace that passes all understanding. The other thing that sustained me through that difficult time were these words from John 15. I am the vine. You are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me, you can do nothing. Abide. It's an old-fashioned word that almost seems like it belongs to another era. On Christmas Eve, we sing, "Oh, come to us, abide with us, our Lord Emmanuel." Or in another famous hymn, we sing, "God of the past, our times are in thy hand, with us, abide." And shortly, we will sing this morning, "The darkness deepens, Lord, with me." means is rare in this or any time, for the lack of a willingness to abide, our world, our communities, our families are impoverished and diminished. The place where Jesus speaks these words in John's Gospel is at the Last Supper, during the same night in which he was betrayed, when those who loved him most failed to abide, to stay with him. Jesus is, in effect, saying farewell to his disciples here in the text. Jesus began his upper room discourse with the venerable image of the vine and the branches, a favorite reference to Israel in the scriptures he knew. As the prophet so often lamented, Israel repeatedly failed to be fruitful branches that grow from the vine. The disciples would fail too, as do disciples now. But then Jesus began to speak about abiding. I am the vine, he said. You are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them will bear much fruit, because apart from me, you can do nothing. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, he continued, ask for whatever you wish and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, he said, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. Admittedly, abiding is not easy work within the human family, but abiding is so important, and indeed consistent with the very nature of Christ in human life. And this is a text about our connectedness with him and his connectedness with us, which is, of course, the ground of our connectedness with one another. And the quality that makes it so is Jesus is willing to stay, to abide with us. The disciples on the road to Emmaus in Luke 24 say to Jesus before they realize who he is, stay or abide with us. It's the same verb. And in his doing so, they recognize who he is. Elsewhere in John's Gospel, Jesus promises the abiding presence of the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, as their teacher and guide, the abiding one who then enables them to do the same work of abiding with others. I fear no foe, with thee at hand to bless, says the old hymn. Ills have no weight, and tears no bitterness. Where is death's sting? Where grave thy victory? I triumph still, if thou abide with me. Recognizing God's staying power gives us staying power. I read a story once about a monastery that had fallen on hard times. There were only a handful of monks left, and they were worried about the future and floundering for ideas, and the abbot of the monastery approached a neighboring rabbi for counsel. The rabbi replied, I have no advice to give you, really. The only thing I can tell you is that one of you could well be the Messiah. The abbot brought this thought back to his monks, but he said the monastic community didn't really know what to do. They just pondered it. And in the months that follow, as they pondered this thought without realizing it, they began to treat each other differently. There was a new sense of love and respect. And in time, others were attracted to their order, and the monastery began to take on new life and flourish again. It makes a difference in our relationship with others who follow Christ when we see that he abides within them as within us. Recognizing God's staying power with us gives us staying power. I have seen such abiding with my own eyes. We can see it most every day if we let open our eyes. I have seen it recently in the love that binds two parents to a child with special needs who struggles to fit in. I've seen it in a family that has not abandoned one of its members who made a tragic choice and who now faces an uncertain future at best. I've seen it in a husband who tenderly and steadfastly attends to and visits his wife, who no longer knows his name. I've seen it in presbytery colleagues who have disagreed for years about so many things, but who cherish the relationship that they share in Christ. I've seen it in a person whose own painful memories of deep grief have not kept her from extending compassionate care to another who is plumbing the same depths. Staying power. Rooted in the staying power of Christ and of Christ's Spirit. Sometimes abiding takes on dimensions of courage and of surging hope and bold steps forward. And at other times, says Dean It is remembering what Psalm 121 teaches us. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. Whether bold or quiet, strident or steadfast, abiding in Christ's love is an act of grace. It is a gift God first gives to us. And when we are at our best, it is a gift we give another. I'm reminded of the story of a young father who was struggling the day of his wife's funeral, trying to put his young son to bed. Both were numb with sorrow. The little boy asked Daddy, "Where is Mommy?" He tried to answer the question, but the little boy kept asking, "Where is Mommy? When is she coming back?" After a lot of attempts to satisfy his son, the father picked up the little boy and put him in his own bed. Finally, the little boy reached out his hand through the darkness and placed it on his father's face, asking, "Daddy, is your face toward me?" Giving assurance, he said, "If your face is toward me, I think I can go to sleep." The father lay beside the young son and prayed, "Oh God, the way is dark, and I do not see my way through right now. But if your face is toward me, somehow, I think I can make it." That is what it means to know that we can abide in him and he in us. This awareness transforms the very fellowship of the church. With his power as the vine, we the branches are joined together. We are one in his love. William Barclay, the Scottish Bible scholar, wrote, "Love is the binding power which holds the whole Christian body together. The tendency of any body of people, sooner or later, is to fly apart. And love is the one bond that will hold them together in unbreakable fellowship." When we know that we're not alone, what does this mean for how we live? For one thing, to believe we're part of the ministry of Jesus and live in his love gives each of us a new way of living. What seemed impossible with our own limited strength and vision is now possible through his mercy and grace and the love and care of those joined with us in the body of Christ. My family has certainly experienced your staying power with us through difficult times. As Christ abides with you, you have abided with us, even when you do not know what to say. Sheila Cassidy, in The Audacity to Believe, tells of being arrested in Chile on trumped-up charges after treating a wounded revolutionary. She was arrested and held without trial, held in a detention camp. She was finally found guilty of a minor infraction, but still held. She was given by a doctor a copy of the New Testament. Leafing through it, she came to that passage in Romans where Paul asks, "Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No. In all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life nor angels nor rulers nor things present nor things to come nor powers nor heights nor depth nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of Christ Jesus our Lord." Sheila writes, "Incredibly, in the midst of fear and loneliness, I was filled with joy. For I knew without any vestige of a doubt that God was with me, and that nothing they could do could ever change that." Martin Luther King Jr. in The Strength of Love tells of a particular tension-packed week that included arrest and threats on his life. He spoke at a mass meeting, and at the end of the meeting, a woman came to him in front of the church and said, "Something is wrong with you. You didn't talk strong tonight." "Oh, nothing is wrong," replied King. "Now you can't fool me. I done told you we are with you all the way. And even if we ain't with you, God's going to take care of you." King writes that through many hard times that followed those words, the very thought that God's going to take care of you kept coming back to him and giving him power to endure. The challenge is to accept that power for ourselves, to bear the fruit that our gospel spoke of. For Christ calls us, each and every one of us, for a purpose. The invitation to abide is not self-serving. It is not to be free of the world, but to be free to be in the world. It is not to be rewarded, but it's to be able to contribute. To truly believe in Christ, it calls us to bear fruit. It is then that we get past the idea of control, and we are able to share by serving. It is then we begin to finally realize what it means to abide in his presence. Friends, the invitation is this. We are called by faith to be part of a larger community, a family created by those who abide in Christ. Joined together by our shared love for him, challenged together to bear fruit for that love into the world, we are connected together in and through Christ. If you are looking for a church home or have questions about faith, know that Pastor Wanda or myself or Pastor Lynn would be happy to talk with you, pray with you, sit with you. Knowing that Christ abides in you and also in your neighbor, the neighbor next to you in your pew, the neighbor down the street, the neighbor at BUCM, the neighbor at the hospital across the ocean in Malawi, what does that mean for how we live our lives? What do we need to prune? What do we need to rediscover? What in our community needs to be watered and tended to? I know, it all sounds awfully scary. But remember, you don't have to do it alone. For Christ abides with us, stays with us. And God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now, as you are able, I invite you to stand where you are and affirm your faith using the historic Apostles' Creed, answering that age-old question, Christian, what do you believe?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body,
seated. Every Sunday we have the prayers of the people, and that is our way of calling home God's abiding presence for ourselves as well as for others. This week we especially want to remember those who have experienced losses, the Tate family, Jane and Sam, and others, the Kilgore family, and the death of Jenny Ferguson. We remember her husband, Sean, and Jenny's sons. We also want to remember the families of Naomi Rostam, that is Barbara Wall, Elizabeth Cobb, and the Rostam family. And then we want to remember the family of a former associate pastor here, Reverend Susan Rice Wall. And then we want to remember those who are welcoming lives, those who have welcomed new life in their families, and those who will this week. Let us pray. God, we thank you for the blessings of this life, and we give you thanks, abiding God, for your presence in them, for families and friends and colleagues and neighbors and even strangers who bring your abiding presence with us. In that abiding love, we pray. We pray for those who are welcoming new life or who have welcomed new life. And then we pray for those who are dying and those who are in families who have lost loved ones, particularly those whose grief and loss is still very near. We ask you to send your comforting love, give solace to those who mourn, console those who grieve. Then we pray, Lord, for those who suffer from illness or from disease, whether it's of mind or body or spirit. Restore them and all those we carry in our hearts to wholeness, wholeness as only you, O God, can bring. And then we pray for those who are in harm's way, those who serve others and put their lives at risk, those who live in dangerous places, those who live in areas of war and strife, those who live in fear, those who worry about employment and bills and debt, those who worry about food and clean water, those who struggle just to find dignity in life. May your grace find peace and bring it to them and abide with them that they may feel your presence. And lastly, Lord, we pray for our leaders, leaders of various nations and cities. Particularly, we lift our nation on the week of the National Day of Prayer. We lift all these needs and all these prayers as we lift our voices now, praying the prayer our Lord taught us, the Lord's Prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I apologize, I've served many churches, and I go back to former churches and not the worthy. You might be interested in knowing that more churches these days are praying, forgive us our sins, as we forgive the sins of others. So it's an interesting study. Now, we worship, responding with God's tithes and our offerings.
Thank you.
rejoicing and walking with God who abides with each and every one of you. I don't know what you may be going through, what darkness you face, but there is a good God that loves you, that walks with you, that stays with you through all of it. Let us pray as we bless the food we are about to receive. Let us pray. Almighty and loving God, we just thank you for the meal we are about to have, for the food, for the hands that have prepared it. We know that table fellowship was important to you. Help us to practice abiding with one another at table. At the road to Emmaus, you were known to the disciples in the breaking of bread. Help us to recognize your presence in the meal ahead. Help us to welcome our guests as we learn more about what you are doing all the way in Malawi, Africa. And as we go, may the love of God, the grace of the Son, Jesus Christ, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of us, now and forever. Amen.